Good morning. Today we'll start with physiology of hearing. This topic will be covered in three parts. So today we'll be discussing about structure and functions of the ear. As you all know, what are the structure, what is the organ of hearing? Ear is the organ of hearing, and what are the functions of the ear? It is the hearing, which is hearing and equilibrium. Cochlea is concerned with hearing, and vestibular apparatus is concerned with equilibrium. Now, what are the main components of the hearing mechanism? One is the ear, that is, it is divided into three parts: outer ear, middle ear, and inner ear. Then the sound waves from the ear through the cochlear nerve, they are transmitted through the to the central nervous system. Now, sound, it begins in the form of the pressure waves. It is transmitted in the form of compression and rarefaction. So sound is transmitted in the form of waves. Now, before starting with the structure of ear, I would like to discuss about the properties of sound. Sound, it has got three properties. First is pitch, loudness, and timbre. Pitch is determined by the frequency, and unit for the frequency of the sound or pitch is hertz. Loudness is determined by the amplitude of the waves, and unit for the loudness or amplitude is decibel. Then timbre for the quality of the sound. It depends upon the complexity and shape of the nerve, sound wave, sorry. Now the pitch of the sound, that is, that a person, normal person can hear, is from 16 to 20,000 hertz. Maximum sensitivity of the human ear is for about 1,000 to 10,000 hertz. Male pitch is 120 hertz and female pitch is 250 hertz. That's why the female sound is very sharp, because the frequency is 250 hertz as compared to male, where frequency of sound is 120 hertz. Now, loudness, it is measured in decibel. There are different decibels at which particular sound is heard. So, zero decibel, it is not the absence of sound, it is the standard reference which is taken for measuring the amplitude of the sound. Folding of paper, it produces a sound of about 10 decibel. Whispering produces the sound of about, loudness of about 10 to 30. And room noise, it produces the loudness of about 30 to 40 decibels. And normal conversation, it takes place at about 40 to 60 decibels. Now, the sound above 140 decibels is painful to the ear. Now, timbre, as I have already told you, it gives quality to the sound. The wave is a complex wave. And when this complex wave is repeated uniformly, then it produces the musical sound. But if this sound is complex, wave is complex, and it is not repeated uniformly or rhythmically, it results into production of noise. Now, ear, as you all know, it is divided into three parts: outer ear, middle ear, and inner ear. Outer ear, it consists, is the slide showing the diagram or the figure of the outer ear and the inner ear. Outer ear, it consists of pinna, external auditory meatus, and external auditory canal. This pinna, it is made up of cartilage and it is covered by skin. Function of the pinna is, it acts as a receiver and it collects sound from the environment and transmit the sounds through the external auditory canal to the internal ear. Then external auditory canal, it is covered by the skin and it has a sebaceous glands as well as ceruminous glands which will produce oil and wax. This external auditory canal is lined by the hairs also, and because of the presence of hair, oil and wax, it prevents the entry of dust particle and small foreign bodies into the ear. Now comes the middle ear. Middle ear, it is an air-filled chamber. The outer wall of the middle, this is the middle ear. Outer wall of the middle ear, it is tympanic membrane, the outer wall of the middle ear. And on the opposite wall, you can see that there is oval window and round windows which are covered by the membrane. Transmission of sound from the external ear to the internal ear occurs through the middle ear, and it is transmitted through the oval window. Then middle ear, it consists of its lateral border is bounded by the tympanic membrane. It consists of three ossicles, that is malleus, incus and stapes bone, and it consists it contains two muscles. One is tensor tympani muscle, which is attached to the handle of malleus, and when it contracts, it pulls the handle of malleus inwards and keeps the tympanic membrane tense. Then another muscle is the stapedius muscle, and this stapedius muscle, it is the shortest muscle present in the body, and it is innervated by the seventh cranial nerve. It is attached to the neck of the stapes bones. Besides that, there is an opening of the eustachian tube in the middle ear, which connects the middle ear to the pharynx. Normally, this tube is closed, but it opens during the chewing, yawning, and swallowing. It equalizes the pressure on both the sides of the tympanic membrane. So, we'll discuss all these structures one by one. Tympanic membrane, it is conical in shape, made up of connective tissue, which on the outer side is covered with the skin and inner side is covered with the mucous membrane. It is concave in shape with concavity facing towards the external auditory canal, and handle of malleus is attached on the inner side where the convexity is maximum. So that portion is known as umbo. So this is umbo, and the handle of malleus is attached to the umbo. Now this membrane, tympanic membrane, it vibrates when the sound strikes the tympanic membrane. This tympanic membrane is kept tense by the contraction of tensor tympani muscle. Tensor tympani muscle, it is attached to the handle of malleus, neck of the malleus, and when it contracts, it will pull the handle of malleus inwards, and it will keep this tympanic membrane tense, as a result of which, when the sound strikes the tympanic membrane, it will be set into vibration. Now, the malleus is connected with the incus through the ligaments, and incus is attached to the stapes bone. So, foot plate of the stapes, this is the foot plate of the stapes, it lies against the oval window, and it is attached to the oval window through the annular ligaments. This attachment is loose, which allows the forward and backward movement of the foot plate of the stapes. So, when the vibrations, they enter into the middle ear, they are transmitted to the internal ear through this oval window. It will push in the it will push the membrane at the oval window in the inward direction, and the vibrations will be set into the internal ear. Now all these three bones or the ossicles, you can say, they act like a rigid pillar. When the loud sound enters into the ear, and it protects the internal ear from the damaging effect of the loud sound. So these are all three ossicles. Now this diagram shows two muscles. One is the tensor tympani muscles, which is attached to the malleus bone, and stapedius muscle, which is attached to the neck of the stapes bone. Now, what are the functions of middle ear? Functions of the middle ear: tympanic membrane, it acts as a receiver and resonator, and it converts sound waves, or you can say acoustic energy, into the mechanical energy. It helps in the conduction of sound from the external ear to the internal ear. A eustachian tube, it equalizes the pressure on both the sides of the tympanic membrane. Then the two main functions of the middle ear are impedance matching and attenuation, or you can say tympanic reflex. So these are the two main functions. All other functions of the middle ear, but these are the two main functions, that is impedance matching and attenuation or tympanic reflex. What is impedance matching? Impedance matching is the matching between the sound waves in the air and sound vibrations in the fluid of cochlea. Now, impedance matching is about 50 to 75% perfect for the sound frequencies between 300 to 3000 hertz. Now, how this impedance matching is done between the sound waves in the air and sound vibrations in the fluid of cochlea? There are two mechanisms. This, all the three ossicles which are present in the ear, they act like a liver system. Now, the amplitude of movement at the foot plate of stapes is about 3/4 as compared to the movement of handle of malleus. So these ossicles, they do not increase the amplitude of movement, but they will increase the force of movement at the foot plate of the stapes by 1.3 times. So these ear ossicles, they will increase the force of movement by 1.3 times at the foot plate of stapes. Next is that the area of the tympanic membrane is much more as compared to foot plate of the stapes. So area of the tympanic membrane is about 55 millimeters square, and that of the oval window is 3.2 millimeters square. That means the difference is of 17 folds. So the amount of pressure that is produced at the foot plate of stapes is about 22 folds. That is 17 into 1.3 comes out to be 22 times. So there is increase in the pressure at the foot plate of stapes is about 22 times, and this increased pressure is required to set the vibrations into the fluid of the cochlea, because the inertia of the fluid is much more as compared to air. So more pressure is required, and this is achieved through impedance matching. So this figure, it shows the difference in the surface area of the tympanic membrane and the footplate of the stapes. Now, what is attenuation reflex? Attenuation reflex, it is a protective reflex which protects the inner ear from the very loud intensities entering into the ear. This attenuation reflex, it begins after 40 to 80 milliseconds after the loud sounds enter into the ear, and it causes contraction of the tensor tympani muscle and stapedius muscle, as a result of which this ossicular system, it is converted into the rigid pillar and decreases the transmission of sound to internal ear by 30 to 40 decibels. Now, what is the advantage of the attenuation reflex? Advantage of the attenuation reflex is it protects the cochlea from the damage that is produced as a result of loud noise. Second, it will mask the entry of low frequency sounds from the environment, which are below 1000 hertz. So a person can concentrate on the sounds above 1000 hertz where the normal conversation takes place. Third advantage of this attenuation reflex is it decreases the sensitivity of hearing to his or her own speech. It decreases the sensitivity of the person to his or her own speech, as a result of which person can talk normally without getting the sounds back into the ear. Now third portion of the ear is internal ear. Internal ear, it consists of two parts, bony labyrinth and membranous labyrinth. Bony labyrinth, it is present in the petrous part of the temporal bone and it covers the membranous labyrinth. Membranous labyrinth, it includes cochlea and vestibular apparatus. Cochlea is concerned with hearing and vestibular apparatus, it is concerned with balance and equilibrium. So cochlea, it is the coiled tube around 2 and 3/4 turns. It looks like the shell of the snail. You must have already seen that. Now vestibular apparatus, it consists of three parts, utricle, saccule and semicircular canals. This vestibular apparatus we'll discuss afterwards. Today we'll be discussing about the mechanism of hearing. So we'll study the structure of cochlea in details. Now this is the diagram of the internal ear, or you can say membranous labyrinth. It consists of cochlea, which is a coiled tube. Okay, it is concerned with hearing, and the vestibular apparatus, which consists of utricles, saccules and three semicircular canals, which lie at right angle to each other, and it is concerned with equilibrium. Now this is the diagram of the cochlea when it is open. So it is a tube which consists of three parts. It is divided into three parts by the two membrane. One is the Ressner's membrane and another is the basilar membrane. It divides the tube of the cochlea into three parts. Above is the scala vestibuli, scala media in between and scala tympani below. So Ressner's membrane, it separates scala vestibuli and scala media, and the basilar membrane, it separates scala media and scala tympani. Scala vestibuli and scala tympani, they are filled with perilymph, and scala media is filled with endolymph. Scala vestibuli and scala media, scala vestibuli and scala tympani, they join or they communicate with each other at the apex of the cochlea, that is known as helicotrema. Now the fluid is set into vibration when the foot plate of stapes moves against the oval window. Once the fluid is set into vibrations, the vibrations will be occurring in the fluid which is present in the scala vestibula, and this movement will enter into the scala tympani through the helicotrema. And this will cause bulging of round window towards the middle ear. Now the Ressner membrane, as I have already told you, it separates the scala vestibuli from the scala media. This membrane, Ressner's membrane, is very thin membrane, and medially it is attached to the medial wall at the point that is known as limbus, and laterally it is attached to the lateral wall just above the stria vascularis, which I'll show you in the next diagram. So this listener membrane is very thin, and the vibrations, they travel from the scalar vestibular into the scalar media as if very easily, as if no membrane exists between the two. Then the basilar membrane, it divides the scalar media and scalar tympani. This basilar membrane, it is the fibrous membrane made up of 20 to 30,000 fibers, and these fibers are stiff, elastic and reed-like, which are attached at the distal end. That is, they are attached to the modulus centrally, and the distal and basal end is attached and distal end is free. It is embedded in the loose basilar membrane. So it vibrates like a reed of harmonica. Now another characteristics of the basilar membrane is that the length of the fibers, they increase from the base to the apex, that is towards the helicotrema, and the diameter of the fiber, it decreases from base to apex. So thick and short fibers, they are present near the base. Thick and short fibers, they are present near the base of the cochlea, and thin and long fibers, they are present near the helicotrema. As a result of which, base fibers will be stimulated, because they are thick and short, they will be stimulated, or they are most sensitive to high frequency sounds, and the thin and long fibers which are present towards the helicotrema, they will be most sensitive to the low frequency sounds. Now this is the figure showing the three chambers of the cochlea. This is the scala vestibuli, scala media, which is divided by the Ricinus membrane. This Ricinus membrane is very thin, and medially it is attached to the limbus. This portion is limbus, and laterally it is attached to the lateral wall just above the stria vascularis. This is the network of the blood vessels, which is known as stria vascularis. And the Ricinus membrane is attached just laterally, just above the stria vascularis. This scala vestibuli and scala tympani, they are filled with the perilymph, and the scala media is filled with the endolymph, which is rich in potassium ion. Then the base. This is the diagram showing the basilar membrane. Okay, and this above the basilar membrane, are on the surface of the basilar membrane are present the receptors for hearing, that is the hair cells of organ of Corti. So this diagram, it shows the structure of organ of Corti. So the organ of Corti, it is present, it is consist of hair cells. So there are two types of hair cells, internal hair cells and single row of internal hair cells, and 3 to 4 layers of external hair cells. There are about 3500 internal hair cells present in the organ of Corti, and about 12,000 external hair cells, or you can say outer hair cells. So inner hair cells, they are responsible for detection of the sound. They are more sensitive. So these hair cells, you can see they are supported by the supporting cells, which are known as phalangeal cells. The base and sides of the hair cells, they synapse with the network of cochlear nerve fibers, which lead into the spiral ganglion. And from the spiral ganglion, it is present in the modulus. And from the spiral ganglion, the nerve fibers arise, which will travel into the cochlear nerve, and sensations will be transmitted to the central nervous system. Now, the upper end of these hair cells, they are fixed in the rigid plate that is known as reticular lamina. This reticular lamina is supported by the two rods, which are known as rods of corti, and the space between the two is known as tunnel of corti. Now, perilymph is present in the tunnel of corti. And this rods of corti, they are supported or they are attached to the basilar membrane. Now, you can see that from the apex or the tip of the hair cells arise hundreds of small cells which are known, hair cells which are known as stereocilia. And these stereocilia, they project into the scala media and they are bathed in the endolymph. Now, these hair cells, their size, it increases gradually as the hair cells, they move away from the modulus, and the largest stereocilia is known as kinocilium. When the hair cells, they move, all the hair cells, they move towards the kinocilium, it results into depolarization, and when the hair cells, they move away from the kinocilium, it results into hyperpolarization. Now, these tip of the hair cells, they are embedded in the gelatinous coat, which is known as tectorial membrane. Okay. Now, 90% of the innervation is to the inner hair cells. Therefore, inner hair cells are very important in detection of the sound. Now, outer hair cells, what is the function of outer hair cells? Outer hair cells play a very important role in controlling the sensitivity of the inner hair cells. They receive the innervation from the superior and inferior olivary nucleus, and they control the sensitivity of the internal ear, internal hair cells, sorry. Now, as the basilar membrane, it moves in the upward direction, it causes the movement of reticular lamina in the upward and inward direction. And when the basilar movement, it occurs in the downward direction, it causes the movement of the reticular lamina into the outward and downward direction. Because of the upward and downward, inward and outward movement of this reticular lamina, it causes the movement of hair cells against the tectorial membrane, resulting into bending of hair cells and generation of receptor potential. Now, how this receptor potential develops, we will discuss in the next class. Now, again, this diagram is showing the arrangement of a diagram of the organ of corti with the external and internal row of hair cells. This is the again same diagram, and here you can see that cilia, they are gradually increasing in the length, and the cilia with the longest length, it is known as kinocilium. Now, what are the functions of the hair cells, inner hair cells and outer hair cells? Inner hair cells, they are the primary hair cells, and the potential, receptor potential, auditory potential, it develops in these inner hair cells, and once the receptor potential is developed, it is transmitted through the auditory nerve to the central nervous system. Now, as I have already told you that inner hair cells, it receives 95% of the innervation. Now, what are the functions? It detects the sound. It is very sensitive for the perception of sound. Now, what are the functions of the outer hair cells? Outer hair cells, they detect the presence of sound and they control the sensitivity of the inner hair cells. They improve the hearing by influencing the vibration pattern of the basilar membrane. Now, as I have already told you that the basilar membrane, it is made up of stiff elastic and reed like fibers and their length. It increases from base to apex, and diameter it decreases from base to apex. As a result, the fibers which are present towards the base, they are thick and short fibers, and they will be most sensitive to the high frequency sound. And the long and thin fibers present towards the apex, they are most sensitive to low frequency sounds. Intermediate frequency of sounds will cause stimulation of the intermediate portion of the basilar membrane. So, what are the characteristics of the sound which travels along the basilar membrane? Initially, each sound is weak to begin. Okay, each sound is weak, sound waves is weak initially, but it becomes stronger as it reaches that portion of the basilar membrane whose natural resonant frequency is same as that of the frequency of sound vibration. So when the sound vibration reaches that portion of the basilar membrane whose frequency matches with the sound frequency, at that portion, these sound waves, they will increase in amplitude, they will become more strong, and they will cause maximum vibrations or the movement in the basilar membrane. As a result of which, entire energy of the sound wave will be dissipated, and that sound wave will die at that point and it will not travel further. So this helps in discriminating various intensities of sound, and this theory is known as place theory for determining the different frequencies of the sound. Now, in initial portion, the movement of sound wave is very fast, which allows the differentiation of high frequency of sound in the initial portion. Otherwise, there would be bunching of the frequency of sound at the basal portion. So this is the place theory, and once the particular portion of the basilar membrane, it gets excited, then it will cause stimulation of the hair cells present in that portion of the nerve fiber, basilar membrane. Receptor potential will be generated, and it will cause stimulation of particular types of neurons present in the central nervous system, which are sensitive to that particular frequency of sound. Now, this diagram, it shows the distribution of frequency of sound which will be heard maximally from base to apex. This is the base of the cochlea, this is the apex of the cochlea. At the base, you can hear the, it is sensitive to 20,000 hertz, and as you move towards the apex, it will be stimulated by the low frequency sounds. So up to 200 hertz, it will be detected by the cochlea, and the theory which helps in discriminating the sound frequency up to 200 hertz is place theory. Okay, then after the place theory, frequency of sound from 200 to 20 will be heard by the Wohle's principle that we will discuss afterwards. So that helps in discriminating the frequency of sound along the basilar membrane of the cochlea. Now this diagram, it shows the movement or the transmission of the sound waves in cochlea, which I have already explained it to you, that high frequency sound will stimulate the basal portion of the basilar membrane, or you can say that basilar portion of the basilar membrane is more sensitive to high frequency sounds. Now low frequency sound, they will cause the movement of the basilar membrane towards the apex, an intermediate frequency of sound, it will cause the movement of the basilar membrane in the intermediate distance, where the frequency of sound wave matches the natural resonant frequency of the basilar membrane. So you can see that there is maximum displacement of the basilar membrane, and once there is maximum movement of the basilar membrane, then the energy, entire energy will be dissipated and the wave will die out at this particular point and it will not move further. So when there is maximum movement of this portion of the basilar membrane, it will cause stimulation of the hair cells present in this particular portion of the basilar membrane, which will cause stimulation of particular type of neurons in the central nervous system, which helps in differentiating the different frequencies of sound. Thank you so much.